reflections with you about and on the birthday of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. What better time to reflect on true love on his birthday? I feel a very personal connection to Dr. King because Montgomery, Alabama is the place in which I was born, I was reared, and I finished high school. And back in 1954, the African American community was elated, and they were welcoming when Dr. King arrived in Montgomery as the pastor of Dexter Avenue Baptist Church. He was young, he was articulate, he was handsome, and a man of God with a growing family. It didn't take long for the whole community to realize that Dr. King was a God-sent preacher, an acknowledged leader, and had the strength to love. I was there. I had barely settled in my college freshman year, December 1955, when my hometown exploded around Mrs. Rosa Parks. And Mrs. Rosa Parks was a friend of my family, but we knew that she was a mild-mannered, quiet person. But to hear this, that this lady had said no to moving to the back of the bus, was a little unnerving to me. She said no to moving to that back. But more importantly, she said no to racial segregation, to discrimination, and to bigotry. I felt overwhelmed and frightened as I heard what was happening back home. It was unbelievable to me that Mrs. Parks had such courage and foresight to do what she did in such a mean and hostile environment. However, I know now God was with her in his enduring love and his grace. The city quickly organized, recruiting Dr. King as a leader of the Montgomery Improvement Association and began the well-known civil rights movement. And this movement eventually led to the passing of the 1965 Civil Rights Act. So I am intrigued by how today's readings fit succinctly with Dr. King's sermon, and that sermon that I'm talking about is titled, The Strength to Love. The purpose of Dr. King's sermon was to give a clear and simple explanation of God's perfect love that works within us and works for us. This was one of the first sermons that Dr. King delivered at the Ebenezer Baptist Church after arriving in Atlanta from Montgomery in 1960. The word strength in the title of the sermon points to the fact that there is a struggle in loving. Loving is not just a pitter-pat, good-feeling attraction as we sometimes want to believe. It's more than that. Dr. King explains that true love has a significant balance between a tough mind and a tender heart. And also that a noticeable imbalance of these two opposites is not love. Extreme degrees of imbalance can produce a stressful relationship that ends up with volatile consequences. People who have this imbalance to tough mindedness is Scrooge-like. They can't love. They are more interested in physical interactions. They're not able to experience true friendship. They're self-centered. They don't respect people who are different from themselves, and et cetera. But on the other hand, people who are at the other end of the spectrum are gullible-like. They can't say no, and they can't even express their own belief system. They avoid conflict, and they're not good leaders. And none of these is true love. God does not exhibit any of these characteristics because God is perfect in his love. However, as humans, we do not reach that perfection, but we should also and always strive for the best balance possible. In the book of Matthew, Jesus expresses a blend of the two opposites between a tough mind and tender heart when he sent his disciples to a mean and cruel world of that day. And he said to them, "Behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be ye therefore as wise as serpents and harmless as doves." Thank you, Dr. King, for that sermon back in 1960, The Strength to Love. Our readings today allow us to see God's action as he gives his love freely. Isaiah describes the Israelites as a chastised nation coming out of a place of darkness, being welcomed with joy and jubilation. They were being welcomed back to the flock. But God did more for them. He commissioned them to serve as a light to all nations and to bring salvation to all of the earth. What a loving God. And St. Paul writes through the Corinthians in the second reading that the division he's hearing about will produce the demise of the church. And that would be unacceptable. So St. Paul instructed them to address the factions by calling on God for help and demonstrating true love for one another. God would then answer their call and provide his saving love and grace. And then in the gospel, John the Baptist informs the Israelites that he, John, was not the Messiah as they thought he was because he was baptizing. He was doing his job. He was baptizing and then he was baptizing more. So the people thought he must be the Messiah. But John wanted them to know that Jesus ranks in front of me. And the purpose of baptizing was to make Jesus and his identity known. And with the Holy Spirit, God acted with his love to bring new deliverance to the Israelites. Now, in applying this true love approach to child rearing, and that's something I do know something about, parents many times will have difficulties blending the two opposites, a tough mind and a tender heart. In my own life, my husband and I attended this church together, so many of you may have known him before he passed. We knew nothing about parenting when we got married. I mean, it was a trial and error kind of situation. But we decided learned slowly how to balance those two opposites without knowing what we were doing. And we knew that it was impossible, it was impractical for us to show division in our interactions and our actions with our five sons and daughters. Therefore, tough-mindedness and tender-hearted approach projected the true love they needed in growing up and maturing. And I also always feel that children, babies, must get a course in reading human behavior before they're born, because it doesn't take long for them to use that. And if we don't realize what's happening, we kind of lose them in the struggle. But I can say to you, looking at my five sons and one daughter at this present time, that they have a deep love for their own families. And they are giving back to this community and the respective communities in which they live. And I always say to parents that one of the words that children learn early, but it's so important that they understand the limits of that, is the word no. And as parents, how we legislate that is going to be important. So, in all of those interactions with our children, with our students, the teachers who are here, for our church members and our community members, true love happens when we rely on God's love. Why is that? Because God is love. Thank you.